mighty name of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen. The 51 say, Father, please fill me with your spirit of wisdom. Fill me with your spirit of wisdom. The Bible says wisdom is a principal thing. He said, get wisdom with all thy getting. Get understanding. Let's begin to ask for the wisdom of God. The wisdom that is easily entreated. Godly wisdom. The wisdom that is not with partiality. It's not with hypocrisy. The wisdom that is peaceful. Let's begin to ask God, endow me with godly wisdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, in my marriage, give me wisdom. In the church of God, give me wisdom. In the ministerial work, give me wisdom. In my relationship with my children, give me wisdom. In my relationship with my spouse, give me wisdom. In the name of Jesus Christ. Let's begin to pray. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we ask, O Lord, that you give us wisdom, O Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, we pray that you give us wisdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, in all our endeavor, we ask for the spirit of wisdom. Baptize us. Feed us, O Lord, in the spirit of wisdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, feed us, O Lord. Baptize us, O Lord, in the spirit of wisdom. In the name of Jesus Christ, in Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Father, you are my hope. Don't let my expectation be cut short. Father, you are my hope. Don't let my expectation be cut short. Shall we begin to pray? Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, you are the hope of our glory, O Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, let not our expectation be cut short. In the name of Jesus Christ, spiritual expectation, material expectation, financial expectation, marital expectation, academic expectation, let it not be cut short. Ministerial expectation, let it not be cut short. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, let it not be cut short. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. We're going to pray, Father. Let my joy be perfectly full in the name of Jesus Christ. Let my joy, wherever you are trusting God for, in for one thing or the other, that is there. That is the kind of joy, something that can bring you joy. Let us begin to pray. It's like God, perfect that which concerns all my needs. In the name of Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit will pray this morning. Let our joy be perfectly full in this church, O Lord. Let all our joy, O Lord, be perfectly full in the name of Jesus Christ. Let our joy be perfectly full in the name of Jesus Christ. Let our joy be perfectly full. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Father, from henceforth, let my testimony be full and permanent. Be full and permanent. Shall we begin to pray? My Father, from henceforth, let my testimony be full and permanent. Every member of this church, let our testimony be full and let it be permanent. In the name of Jesus Christ, let our testimony be full and let it be permanent. In the name of Jesus Christ, let our testimony be full and be permanent. In the name of Jesus Christ, let the enemy be put to shame, even in our lives, even in our home, in every of our endeavor. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Father, give me and my neighbor perfect blessings. Give me and my neighbor perfect blessings. Every member of this church, let us pray for perfect blessing in every individual life. Spiritual blessing, material blessing, financial blessing, marital blessing, all the round about blessing. Then begin to pray that the Holy Spirit should give us and our neighbor. In the name of Jesus, perfect blessing. Blessing for the time and season. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, that will give us perfect blessing. In this church, O Lord, as the church, O Lord, we declare perfect blessing. In the name of Jesus Christ, spiritually, physically, materially, financially, maritally, that will give us perfect blessing. In the name of Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, give us perfect blessing. In the name of Jesus Christ, let's begin to commit our needs into the hands of God. You know what you want from God. Begin to use a meaning just to tell God, this area, that you meet me at the point of my need. In there will be miracles concerning what I'm trusting you for. In this month of Judah, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, let there be miracle in this area concerning our health, concerning spiritual man, concerning our job, concerning our career. Let there be perfection. Let there be miracle in the name of Jesus Christ. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, we trust in you, O Lord. Holy Spirit, we rely on you. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray.
Amen.
After the father's prayer, then he told us that from today there is fasting, 7 days fasting. And it's meant to thank God, to appreciate God, to give him all the glory, to give him all the honor, to give him all adoration, even in our lives. Then he also says, after thanking God, we should ask for mercy, even for our family, for the body of Christ, and for the whole nation. And let us begin to pray, and begin to ask for mercy, the mercy of God, even concerning these 7 days, thanking him and asking for mercy. Let us pray. The Bible says, they that wait upon the Lord, he will renew their strength. Let's begin to pray, for enablement. Let's begin to pray for grace, to be able to fast according to the will of God. Shall we begin to pray for the strength of God? For every member of this church, every member of RCCG, even worldwide, let's begin to pray for the grace to be able to observe him in spirit and in truth. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask for the grace of God to be able to wait on you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we ask for the grace of God to be able to stay in your presence, O Lord. We ask for the grace, O Lord, to be able to dance even to the glory of your name, to thank you in everything, even that we are passing through, that we receive grace, we receive enablement. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, God, the Holy Spirit, let us begin to pray for that man of praise, that man of that will make us to thank God from the depth of our heart, from our spirit man. Let's begin to pray. Holy Spirit, we ask your mighty hand to prevail. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we ask your mighty hand to prevail. Break our city. The Holy Mama Zondelegerebor. Holy Spirit, we depend upon you. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we depend upon you. In the name of Jesus Christ, strengthen us, O Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit, strengthen us, even for this waiting. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Let us commit as we be gathering together every evening. Every evening except today's evening. Because we have already prayed and we're still going to praise God during the service. We're going to pray that the Holy Spirit himself should have his way. As we are meeting 6 to 6:30 every day, just to thank God and appreciate God and ask for mercy as it was commanded. We're going to pray that the Holy Spirit himself should take over this program. Shall we begin to pray? Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, we come before you, come in the blood of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, we pray that you take control, oh Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, that you take preeminent, even of this praying program, thanking you, appreciating your faithfulness, that you take over, oh Lord. Take control. Let's begin to pray as many that the Lord is going to use to lead in one day, even in all these days. Let's pray that the Holy Spirit should walk in them, both to win and to do of his good pleasure. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, that we ask for your mercy, oh Lord. As many, oh Lord, that will be used, oh Lord, as a vessel, that you walk in everyone, both to will and to do of your good pleasure. In the name of Jesus Christ, let us commit the service of today to the hands of God. Let us commit the word of God into the hands of God, that the Holy Spirit himself will take control even of his word. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, that the Almighty God will have his way. In the name of Jesus Christ, Holy Spirit will take preeminence. He sent forth his word and he healed them. Bring them out of their destruction. Let's begin to pray that the Holy Spirit will speak to us through his word. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, the vessel that the Lord has prepared, even from Sunday school, even downward. Let's begin to pray that the Almighty God will walk in them. Holy Spirit will take his hand, even upon them, in leading the prayer, even the choir ministry. We are going to make an announcement, even in the world, in Thanksgiving service. Let's begin to pray that the Holy Spirit himself will take control. Holy Spirit himself will have his way, even in our midst, in Jesus' mighty name. Let's commit all his people keep to his hand, that wherever his people are, let us seduce their coming, every hindrance, every barrier, let us answer and destroy. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, Father, we so hold up everyone inside the blood of Jesus Christ that are still on their way, that are still in their home, that the Holy Spirit, Lord, that you bring them in the name of Jesus Christ, that you bring them, oh Lord, glorify yourself, even in our midst today. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are put and destroy every hindrance, every barrier, even on the way of your people. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, Holy Spirit, that you take control, that you take charge. In the mighty name of God the Father, begin to pray for garment of praise. Even as we come together, even this morning, let's begin to pray, garment of praise. This is the time that we worship the Lord, even in the present church of God worldwide. Let's begin to pray that the Holy Spirit will work in us so that our praise and worship will be sweet-smelling savour, even in His presence. Shall we begin to pray that the Holy Spirit will endow us, even as a church, with garment of praise, that our praise will be genuine, even from the will come from a genuine heart. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, not a heart of bitterness, in the name of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit will pray, in the name of Jesus Christ, that our thanksgiving, oh Lord, even will be genuine, even in your presence, oh Lord, will be acceptable, even in your sight, oh Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, this morning give us the garment of praise. Thank you, King of Glory. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you, we worship you, we give you all the glory. We give you all the honor. We give you all adoration. Thank you for making us to sing even the first Sunday of this month. We say to you alone be all the glory. To you alone be all the honor. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, we commit the rest of the service into your hand. We pray that you have your way. Glorify yourself in our midst. We receive the garment of praise to worship you from a genuine heart. Heart that is full of your glory, of your beauty, of your holiness. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Every hindrance to praise and worshiping you, that we cancel or put out of our ways, out of our mind, in the name of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, help us to praise you genuinely. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Let's have a seat. Let's come in the word of God. Let's be honest with the announcement. And your Holy Spirit will give us understanding. That his name alone, there is nothing that we do without. Father God in heaven, just want to thank you and appreciate you for the grace given to us to be your presence. It's not by might, it's not by power. We have come once again to learn and to hear. Holy Spirit, help us in Jesus' name. Give us understanding of your word in Jesus' name. Let the entrance of your word bring light in Jesus' name. Thank you, faithful Father. Blessed be the Holy Name. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
You are welcome in Jesus' name. Go on, quickly remind us of the topic we started. How did you know that? You are very brilliant. Small pencil is better than long memory. That is the advantage of writing things down. God bless you, Radio. God will continue to strengthen you. Very important. So we want to continue our discussion. Heavenly principle for earthly victory. Heavenly principle for earthly victory. We saw one of the most important statements in Scripture, 2 Timothy 4, 6 to 8. 2 Timothy 4, 6 to 8. Apostle Paul, in his last letter, when he was about to die, he made this statement. When he looked back at his life, he was facing death with satisfaction. He was a fulfilled man. He wanted to die happy. He said, this made now, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy 4. Said, I am ready to be poured out. The days of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I am already being poured out, you see, as a drink. And the time of my departure is at hand. Yes. I have fought the good fight of faith. I have finished what? I have kept the faith. What a testimony. And last week I said, according to Erickson, stages of psychosocial development, this particular statement is called what? I said, the stages of life is divided into eight. And because of our time, I didn't go through all this, but I mentioned that this particular statement is called what? When a man over 60 years, when you look back, you look at your life, you are satisfied with how far you have gone. Some people are satisfied, some people are disturbed and discouraged because they knew they wasted their time, they wasted their life and destiny. So they are looking forward to death with bitterness, which discouragement. I said that one is referred to as what? Integrity versus what? Despair. That shall never be a portion in Jesus' name. We are going to be satisfied with life in Jesus' name. We are going to serve our generation in Jesus' name. So the question we raise is this. How could this man, despite the way he suffered, despite the trials, despite the tribulation, despite the persecution, despite the homelessness, despite the imprisonment, how could it have come up with this kind of statement? So we are looking to the principle which is applicable for us. How can we live this Christian race fulfilled? How can we, despite the tribulation, despite the COVID, despite the challenges, despite the persecution, despite what is going on all over the world, how can we begin to live victoriously? How can we endure hardness as a good soldier of the Lord? Very, very important. Because Christianity or spirituality is not an earthly life. Christianity what? Is an heavenly life. And we cannot dominate, we cannot live victoriously, we cannot overcome the flesh, we cannot overcome the devil, we cannot overcome the world in the energy of the flesh. That is why we have to make use of the resources that God has made available for us. Colossians 3 verse 1, he said, if indeed you are born again, we should seek the things where? That are in heaven, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above. And that is what Matthew 6, 33 said. Seek him first. He does not say we should not seek other things, but our priority should be what? The kingdom of God. Why? Because Philippians 3:20 says, our citizenship is what? It's in heaven. Very, very important. So we said number one is we have to conform. We should not conform to this world. What are we supposed to conform to? What are we supposed to conform to? To the image of Christ. We are supposed to conform to the image of Christ. Romans 8:29. Be conformed to the image of Christ. That is why our focus must be on Christ, looking unto Jesus. Very, very important. So this morning we are going to another very powerful principle. And that is actually our main text, 2 Corinthians 4:16. There are three principles in this place. We are going to look into one. Three principles in this place. We are going to look into one. Can we read together? I want to read. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Even though our outward man is perishing, yet the inward man is what? So number one principle, we want to look into this one. Further, we will look at 17. Three principles. This is one. Number two. For our what? Light affliction. You see, despite the fact that there is no man that ever suffered apart from Christ more than Paul. So there is no suffering or challenges we are going through in life that is even close to what Paul has gone through. But look at what he called it. Our light, I love Paul. He didn't want to say my affliction. He always pluralized things. Because he was such a humble man. For our what? Light affliction. Look at it. Which is but for what? A woman. Weeping may endure for what? A man. Joy comments. Which for a woman is working for us a far more exceedingly and what? Eternal weight of glory. All that we are passing through is for our sake. The scripture that says all things are working together for good is more of our eternity than for now. That is why I told us the other time, somebody wrote a book and said, our best year, they are ahead of us. The pathway of the just shining what? More and more. Look at the third principle, 18. You see, why we do not look at the things which are what? Seen. But at things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are what?
Temporary.
But the things which are seen are what? Three awesome heavenly principles. Oh, sorry. Praise the Lord. Display the first one as verse 16, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 16. The Lord will give us understanding in Jesus' name. So we are looking into the message we started last week. Heavenly principle for heavenly victory. So the number one due principle is based on this scripture, 2 Corinthians 4, 16. And the principle is delivering it again. Therefore, we do not what? Lose heart. We are not discouraged. We are not depressed. Even though our outward man is what? Perishing. The inward man is renewed day by day. So the principle is this. Pay the greatest attention to the inward man than the outward man. Pay the greatest attention to the inward man more than the outward man. Can we say it together?
Pay the greatest attention to the inward man.
That is to say, pay the greatest attention to spiritual things than physical things. Pay the greatest attention, put value on developing your inner mind than developing your pastoral mind. Very, very important. Why? Knowing that it is the spiritual that controls what? The physical. Very, very important. The highest priority to building inner strength than physical strength. That is why the Bible says, seek what? First. It did not say you should not seek other things. Seek ye first what? The kingdom of God and his righteousness. Very, very important. We have to pay attention to what God is paying attention to. We have to lay more emphasis onto that which God is laying more emphasis on. 1 Samuel 16. You see now, 1 Samuel 16. 6, starting from 6. Very important story. Pay more attention, lay more value to what God is paying attention to. Can we read it together? So it was when they came that he looked at Eliab. Who is that? Prophet Samuel. This is the prophet. Prophet, one of the highest prophets of the time that God was using mightily. Look at what happened. He was supposed to go and anoint a member of the household of his family. So it was when they came that he looked at Eliab and said, you will have made it. Mistake. If you are sleeping, I'm going to call you out. Some people are closing their eyes and I'll call you out to come and stay with me in the front. And said, surely the anointed is what? Before me. Prophet. Then look at the next verse. Look at the next verse. I'm going to read. I won't read. But the Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his what? Appearance or at the eye of his stature. Because I am what? Look at the next one. It's a place to mark your Bible. If you are a Bible student. For the Lord does not look as man what? See. For man look what? At the outward. But I look at the heart. The heart is the issue. It is against me. The Lord is not looking as men look. It does not mean you should not pay attention to your outward appearance. A lot of people, a lot of people read scripture and they read this one. They just say, God, does not matter. My body. No. He said, man, look at what?
The
two, they are very, very important. Man, look at what?
Answer.
But God, our God, is looking at what?
The heart.
He's looking at our heart. So person to be on what God is looking. Very, very important. Emphasis should be on what God is looking at. We are treating a topic, heavenly principle for active victory. So the number two, and for the sake of all that has been up, following this message, we have a YouTube page. If you go to Living Word Honey, all these messages are there. If you miss, you can go there and look at them. The Lord give us understanding in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So we are supposed to lay emphasis on spiritual things more than physical things, lay more emphasis on building our inner mind than our outer body, paying attention on building our spirit more than our body. We are seeing it. This is one of them. Look at 2 Chronicles 16 verse 9. 2 Chronicles 16 verse 9. The Bible says, the eyes of the Lord runneth through the whole world. Let's read it together. I want to read. For the eyes of the Lord run through and flow through the whole world to show himself strong on behalf of those whose what? As loyal to him. That's okay. That's okay. What is God looking for? The heart. Let's look at another scripture before we continue. Jeremiah 30:21. We have to pay attention to what God is paying attention. There are no good shall be from among them, and their doctrine shall come from their what? Midst. I will come in to draw near, and he shall approach me. For who is this? Who pledged his what? To what? Approach me. Christianity is a matter of the heart. It's not the physical heart that is humbling God. It's our human spirit where God is living. We are going through the message, spirit, soul, and body, according to 1 Thessalonians 5:3. Very, very important. Very, very important. So Paul was saying, though the outward man is perishing, the inward man is being renewed day by day. If you are a believer, you are so concerned about your physical body. A woman was making reference to his husband some years ago. He said, I don't understand. Anytime my husband sees a mirror, he will go to the mirror and be checking his body. Every time. Why? He's so concerned about the actual appearance. It's a proof that your inner man, your inward man, is not growing. Because if you are growing, if you are building your inner man, you will pay less attention to your outward man. Let me read you a beautiful scripture that talks about how the outward man is perishing before we now go into the inward man. Ecclesiastes, in the amplified version, Ecclesiastes 12. I want us to see the way the outward man is perishing. Then also you also see in the last scripture we are going to see in this same text the inward man. If you are speaking, I'm going to call you back. I'm saying it for the second time. Ecclesiastes 12, starting from 1. Look at it. If you look at the whole world today in the Christianity, a lot of us, we have invested so much in the outward appearance. The inward man, that is what we are doing right now. We only build our inward man maybe 30 minutes, 1 hour. But look at the outward man, ladies and gentlemen. Remember earnestly, your what? That you are not your own, but his property now. In the days of your youth. Last week, we said Lamentation 3:29, he said, make sure you bear the yoke in your what? Youth. Then look at what the scripture says. Remember the Lord your God in the time of your youth. Where you are so strong now. But look at the beginning of the outer body. Before the evil days come, all the years gone there, when you will say of physical pleasure, I have no enjoyment there. Verse 2. Before the sun and the light and the moon and the stars are what? Gapping. He's talking about sight impairment. I used to have someone that was close to me. He said, no, I'm going to wait for the latter part of my life. before I go to, I'm going to serve, but I'm going to enjoy her life. And she died after her 68th birthday. And she never got happiness. You see, a time is coming where a man, a woman will not be able to see again. And the glass of depression will turn after the rain tears. Look at verse 3. In the day when the keepers of the house, what is the keepers of the house? The hands and the hand, they begin to shake like this. Tremble. And the strong men, the feet that is carrying us back now, and the knees bow themselves. And you can be able to walk. It's not a cause, it's a process. And the grinder, the molasses, some people are already using pension. Hello. Because as you are growing, all these things are coming. Hello. Then seeds, because they are what? Feeble. And those who look out of the window, who is that? Are what? Darkened. Yes? Four. When the door of the leaves are what? Shut in the street. And the sound of the grinding of the teeth is what? Low. And one rises up at the voice of the bell and the crying of the cock, and all the daughters of music, the hearing is fading away. And the ear are brought what? Low. Look at six. Also, when the old are afraid of danger from that which is what are, you cannot climb that thing. Hello? Some people, after some years, you know, they will not be able to climb stairs. They say, okay, you come down to the post. And tears are in the way, and the almond tree, they are what here, blooms. And the grasshopper, a little thing, is a body. And desire and appetite, what? Fail. Because man goes to his what? Everlasting home. And the mourners go about the streets in the marketplace. Six. Remember your great earnestly now. Before the silver cord of life is snapped apart. All the golden bowl is broken, all the pitcher is broken, and the fountain, all the wheel broken, and the system, and the whole circulatory system of the blood ceases to function. Ladies and gentlemen, look at verse 7. Look at the inward man and the outward man. Then shall the dust of which God made man body. So the outward man is going to return to where it came from. Look at the inward man. Which one is the inward man? The spirit man is going to go to God. Who gave what? Two parts of man. Inward man will go back to God. He never died. That is the part of us that is born again. That is our eternal part. That is the part of what that act in everlasting life. So Paul was saying, though this outward man is perishing, my inward, as I'm growing old, my inside is growing younger. That was why he was able to make that statement. I have poured myself out. The time of my dying is near. I have fought what? Despite what he passed through. Why? Because as he was living this physical life, he was renewing his act on a daily basis. So despite the homelessness, despite the threat of death, despite the persecution, despite the problem, he knew because he was renewing his inner man on a daily basis. The Almighty God will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
So we have done 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Can you do it again? 1 Thessalonians 5:23. Because man, we find man, is a spirit, is that what? A soul, he lives what? In the body. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. And that is the way God even arranged it in scripture. Can we read together? I want to read. And may the God of peace himself sanctify you true and true, separate you from profanities, make you pure and only consecrated to God. And may your what?
Spirit.
Is number one. Emphasis must be given to our spirit, the one that is inside. And what?
Soul.
And what? Body. You preserve sound and complete. And found blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. So what Paul was saying is this. It is with our spirits we make contact with God. Hello? So the real you that is called you is what? The spirit. So with the spirit, somebody should read 1 Corinthians 6:17. That is the part of God of all that make contact with God. 1 Corinthians 6:17. 1 Corinthians 6:17. Just read this on the board. 1 Corinthians 6:17.
But he that is joined unto the Lord
is one spirit. You see, he that is joined to the Lord is what? One spirit. So when you are born again, your spirit is now making contact with God. You are one spirit with God. If a man and a woman, they meet together, they are not one spirit. They are what? Thank you, one flesh. It's a part of us, one flesh. But you and God, your spirit and God's spirit, they are one spirit. Very, very important. So this one made contact with the spirit of God. The soul, that is our self-consciousness. It made contact with it because it contains our mind, our will, our emotion. They express themselves through what? The body. So what Paul was now saying, develop your inner man. Develop your inner man. So the inner man is the inner you. Let's look at Job 33, verse 8. Job 33, read it if you are there to just know about the inner man. Job 32, verse 8. Proverbs 20, verse 27, we are there read for us. Job 32, verse 8. Proverbs 20, 27.
But there is a spirit
in man. Inside man.
And the breath of the Almighty God
giveth him
understanding.
Very, very important. There's a spirit in man. That is what man's spirit. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Amen. Proverbs 20, verse 27.
The Lord's light
penetrate what? Oh, I like that in the Bible. Penetrate the woman's spirit.
Exposing every
hidden works. King James says, the spirit of man is the scandal. But I like that. Look at 1 Corinthians 2:11. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 11. 1 Corinthians 2 verse 11.
What man knoweth the
thing of the man?
Save the spirit of man.
Which is inside of him.
Knoweth no man.
But the spirit of God. You see, the spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, know the things of God. Then the spirit of man know the things of man. Then when the Holy Spirit now tabernacle in your spirit, that is when we have access to the things of God. So that is the area we are supposed to. The Lord will give us understanding in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let me show you this scripture before we close. 1 Peter. Display 1 Peter. 3. 3 to 4. A lot of us, we have interpreted this scripture to relate to women. But that is an error. Can we read together? I want to read. Let not yours be the merely external adorning. Display King James Version. King James Version. In this version. I'll just stop with this scripture. We'll continue next week. In this version. Alright? Okay. Do not let your what? Adornment be merely what? He's not talking to a woman alone. He's talking to everybody. Men don't they dress. Even some men dress more than women. Some men, they pay attention more than women towards their household affairs. Do not let your adornment, your decoration, your dressing be merely. It is not saying you should not dress. Did you see it again? It's not saying you should not dress. But it should not be merely outward. Arranging in hair, wearing of gold, or putting on of apparel. Look at the next verse, ladies and gentlemen. Number one. Rather, box. Let it be what? The eating passing of the heart. With the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very what? Precious in the sight of God. Do you see? Thank God for the outward man. Look at what God is saying in passing on. The beauty of man, the beauty of a woman is not in the physical appearance. The glory of a man, the beauty of a woman radiates from inside. He said it's an ornament of a meek and a quiet spirit, which is so precious. That is the emphasis. That is
where we are supposed to be doing. That is the most important thing. But if you look at the generation today, even in the church, if I give you an assignment now, let us calculate how many hours you have spent on the body today, you'll be surprised. Some people can spend an hour in the bathroom. Mm-hmm. 1 hour in the bathroom, washing the teeth, washing, doing that, and after dressing alone is another 30 minutes. Alone. Making up. It's not, I'm not saying it's not calculated. Then after you do all these things, you now sit down, you eat, hello, you feed it again. How many hours? After service, some people eat like 3 or 4 times in a day. Or 5 times. All of this is the just building the body. Some people in the morning they go and jog. It's very good. We have been taught here. Bodily exercise profit what? Little. But godliness. Godliness is the building of the inner man. It is profitable in all things. Having the benefit of now and what? Insanity. But that little, we encourage us to have it to it. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. But Christian people, you only come to church and just listen to 30 minutes of mercy. And throughout the week, hello. Every day you have your back, you brought your mouth, but spiritually, you don't have your back, you don't brought your spiritual hand. How will you have victory? The Lord will help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The Lord will give us understanding in Jesus' name. Amen. So by the grace of God, so the inner man is the real you, the eternal you. That is the new you, according to Ephesians 4. Look at this scripture. Ephesians 4, 24, and somebody should read Colossians 3, verse 10, as we are going through. Look at it. And that you put on the what? The new man is inside, except that you put it on. Which was created according to what? God. In true righteousness and what? Holiness. That is the part of us that is holy. In the Bible study on Wednesday, we talk about our position and our practice. Do you know? You remember? The Bible says we have been blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places in Christ. That is in our heart. We are partakers of his divine nature. That is our position. That is what God has made happen. But our practice is not so. So everything we need, every resources has been given to us. That is why we are so rich in our position. Very, very important. Very, very important. So this is the part that is so rich in us. Colossians 3, verse 10. Colossians 3, verse 10. Read it.
I have put on the new man.
You see, which is what? How do we renew the inner man? Knowledge. You see, and I put on the new man. That is the new creation. When a man is in Christ, he is what? A new creation. All things are passed away. In the new man, behold, everything has become new. It does not affect your body at that time. Look at it. Who is what renewed? So how do you renew the inner man? Knowledge. Proverbs 24, verse 5. A wise man shall what? Be strong. A man of knowledge increases strength. In the spiritual world, in our spirituality, we cannot prevail by power. Not by might, nor by power. But by the grace of the Lord. The Lord will give us understanding in Jesus' name. So next week, by the grace of God, we'll see the major way to renew our strength. That is why the epistle of Paul is so awesome. You need to understand it. And you see, because of our time, I will not go there right now. The scripture that says Isaiah 40 from 28, have thou not known? Have you not heard? He never grows weary, he never grows tired. He's not talking about our physical body. They that wait upon the Lord is our what? Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through what? What do you think he's talking about? It's the strength of the inner man. There is no believer that can live in victory. You can't overcome the flesh. You cannot overcome the devil. You cannot overcome the world. That is the most important emphasis for a Christian. Building
And that was the prayer. Paul prayed for the Ephesians church in Philippians, Ephesians 5, 16 to the end. That is what we want to deal with by God's grace. He said that you be strengthened with what? Mind. Anytime I read that scripture, I always remember the Yoruba proverb that says, open that the gate. It's not possible to live a Christian life without building your inner mind. I look at the process before my time goes back, said that you might be strengthened with mind. So when you are strengthened with mind, then Christ will begin to dwell in your heart by faith. Then when Christ is dwelling in your heart by faith, then you will be rooted and grounded in love. Then you'll be able to experience the multi-dimensional nature of love. Then you will understand the love of God that passes all knowledge. Then you'll be filled with the fullness of God. Then you'll be able to do exceedingly, abundantly, more than what you are asking or thinking, according to the power that worketh in you. Then you'll be able to give all the glory, all the honor, all the adoration. So let's pray this morning. And the Almighty God will turn our eyes on the holy vanity. That God of heaven will help us to focus on what God is focusing on. All the area we have occupied ourselves with building our body, that God will have mercy. That we want to also spend time building our inner man. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again. We ask for your help, we ask for your strength to be able to focus on what you are focusing on. We receive your help and grace because we cannot do it by might. We cannot do it by our power. Help us to be your will, Lord. Thank you, faithful Father. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Be my cup, Lord. I need tear of love. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven. Fill me till I want more and more. Be my cup, fill it up, and make me whole. Be my cup, Lord.
Which cup are you eating up?
I need your love. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, fill me till I overflow. Fill my cup, fill it up, and I need you.
Father, we have come before you. Fill us, O God, we have come empty. Lord, fill us to the full in the name of Jesus. Every word we are hearing, let them not stand against us on the last day, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Lord, as we hear them on a daily basis, the grace to be the doers give to us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And Lord, as we go into your word this morning, the greatest teacher, teach us by yourself, in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Lord, King of glory, your word will be beneficial to us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Lord, every heart seated here today, we will accept it to your word in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, ancient of this.
Thank you, Father.
For in Jesus' name we have prayed.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Good morning, sirs. Good morning, us.
Good morning.
We are welcome to the presence of the Lord in the name of Jesus, your Father's house and my Father's house. So we will remind ourselves of what we talked about last week. What did we look into last week quickly? Last week, by the grace of God, we looked at a very important topic. Can somebody remind us? Anybody? I should call somebody. I think somebody. We have our manuals with us. Yes.
Marriage
algebra. I wanted the youth to really participate in that one. Marriage algebra part two, and we looked at two lesson outlines. Number one. Quickly, Sister Buki, you don't have your word, man. You forgot. Princess, the first lesson outline says what? Cleave. Cleave to your mate. Cleave to your mate. And the second blessing happens says what? Become one flesh. Praise the Lord. Become one flesh. So by the grace of God this morning, we are looking into conflict management in the family. Conflict management in the family. We know it's in the school. So we are all going to participate. There's no teacher here. We are all learning. Amen. So we are all going to participate. Praise the Lord. Our lesson text should be taken from the book of Genesis chapter 13. Sister Tuki, are you there? Genesis 13, 7 to 9. Tuki, please take that. Genesis 13.
And there was a tree of and the name of Abraham's cattle, and the human generation of the dwell there in the land. And Abraham said unto Lot, let there be no strife, I pray thee, between me and thee, and between my excellent hand and thy excellent, I will be greater. If not the whole land before thee, separate thyself, I pray thee, from me. If thou wilt take the left hand, and then I will go to the right, or if thou departs to the right hand, then I will go to the left. And Lot lifted up his eyes, and beheld all the plain of Jordan, that it was well watered everywhere before the Lord destroyed Sodom. Even as the garden of the Lord. Just nine. Oh, okay.
Thank you. God bless you. So you can see that just talking about the story of Abraham and Lot. And it's an example for us. Some of us, if we were to give Abraham, I am the eldest. I need to choose first. Amen. But he didn't do it that way. He said even the younger one should choose. You know? And our memory verse will be taken from the book of Romans chapter 12, verse 17. Romans 12, 17. This is good so that we all take it together. Romans 12, 17. Praise the Lord. So let's take it together. One, two, go. We pay no one evil for evil. Our regard for holiness is in the sight of all men. In the sight of all men. So as we move forward, the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Our Bible should be ready because we are going to take the reading. I'll just follow you and you take it. Our lesson introduction says, a family is defined as a group of people related by blood. Related by blood, marriage, law, example, adoption, or custom. Generally, conflict can be defined as strong disagreements between people, between groups, etc., that results in often angry arguments. Conflict management is the practice of being able to identify and handle conflicts sensibly, fairly, and efficiently. Conflict is inevitable. No relationship is perfect or conflict-free, but conflict, when managed biblically, can serve as a catalyst for change, an opportunity for a good family growth. Our families will grow in Jesus' name. That is why we are looking into all this. The pastor has taken time to print out all this, and we study so that our families, maybe where we have failed, will pick up from there, and the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. So what are we talking about? That conflict is definitely going to happen, but it's how to manage it that matters. Some of us don't manage conflict well, but the Lord is opening our eyes to some areas where we can manage conflict in homes, and the Lord will give us understanding in Jesus' name. So we'll go to the first lesson outline, conflict in the family and its causes. We want to look at some things that can bring about conflict. What are those things? And the first point here says misunderstanding among members of immediate or extended family. misunderstanding. Maybe the way I put the statement before you, you did not understand, and you take it the other way around. I don't give you an instance. When we were growing up, my younger sister, somebody was to come and take some delivery from me. I left message for her, but she could not deliver it well. So when the woman was complaining, I said, please, she does not know how to communicate it well. My sister took offense that why should I say she doesn't understand? You know, so there are some little things that the enemy will allow to blow in our minds and will turn it to be a problem. So misunderstanding, we should know how to handle it. But to the glory of God, I was able to tell her that this is what I mean. It's not that you don't understand things, but that you did not understand the way I asked you to present it to the person. Secondly, contradictory interests among family members. Your interests might be different from the other one. What I like might be what you don't like. But we should know how to manage it. Like when we are bringing up our children, some will say I want to eat rice. Some will say I want to eat beans. Some will say another thing. But do we eat a different food? No. We still use wisdom and prepare what we want to prepare and ask them to eat, and they will eat. So no matter the differences in our interests, we should know how to blend so that there will be no conflict amongst us. Thirdly, we have incapability in the book of Amos 3:3. Brother John, you are welcome. God bless you. Please, can you place that for us? I was seeing Victor. That's why I said I didn't see John. I was seeing Brother Victor back there. Yes. Amos 3:3. Somebody can just tell us, Bible students.
Can two work together?
Thank you. God bless you. God bless you. Can two work together except they agree? So if you don't agree, you will not move forward. When you quarrel today, like I was telling somebody, why is it that you will take one step forward and you take 10 steps back? Because of argument, you're always arguing over little things, things that don't matter, things that you're supposed to, you know, handle with wisdom. You allow the enemy to blow it, you know, big. A little issue will become something big because we have allowed the enemy doors to enter. So God will give us wisdom in Jesus' name. Number four says, unresolved disagreement. Ephesians 4, 26. Ephesians 4, verse 26 to 27. Ephesians 4, 26 to 27. Be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your wrath. Verse 27. Now give place to the devil. Don't give place to the devil at all. You know, the enemy comes, you will think it's just a small thing. Before you know it, it will turn to something, you'll be shouting on one another. Because you have allowed it. When you give him 1 inch, you go 10 miles. So don't even give him an inch. You see it coming, your spiritual antenna should be attentive. You see that this thing, there's some food, praise the Lord. Some weeks back, something happened. My grandson, the little one, fell down. After that one fell down, after 2 days, the eldest was playing and he fell. I said, no, something is about to happen. The enemy will not leave you alone. You know, I began to bind and cast it because I know it's going somewhere. Praise the Lord. Before you know it now, another bigger thing will happen. So I didn't allow him. I stopped him right there. It's enough. Enough is enough. Pack your load and leave this house. Praise the Lord. So that is how it should be when argument begins. Try to step down. Don't begin to say, I need to win this argument. I need to prove myself. I know how to communicate well. I know how to talk. He must understand me. No. You don't need to prevent yourself. I need to tell you. You don't need to prove yourself right. Amen. God will prove you. Your attitude will prove you. You don't need to begin to agitate. I must do it. He must take it this way. She must take it this way. No. It shouldn't be such things to bring trouble. And we say here, lack of trust. Proverbs 31:11. Lack of trust. If we don't trust one another, maybe the person is used to telling one thing and change Like a chameleon, today you are green, tomorrow you are black. And then maybe you don't want to trust, you need to trust. Amen. You should learn to trust. Over. Did you put it up? Yes. The heart of her husband say we trust her, so she will have no lack of pain. Let your husband trust you. Let your wife trust you. Amen. By what you say, let your word be your bond. When you say this is afternoon, when the person goes out and sees it's afternoon truly, don't say when it is an answer and he says afternoon. You're lying. You should not paint anything. Don't exaggerate. Don't put salt and sugar in anything. Say it the way it is. And let people see you that that is how you are. Amen. When I was still working, somebody who did, when they were doing their dirty things in government, and somebody was coming to my office, they said, I don't know to her. She will not do, she will not agree with you. I didn't know what they were discussing downstairs because my office is upstairs. And when the person came and I rejected what the proposal he brought, he said, the people told me, I said, then why did you come? You know, so let your word be your bond. No matter what others are doing around you, you stand because you're a different person, you're a different species. Amen. Amen. Like Pastor used to say, super has been added to our natural. Praise the Lord. Amen. So you must be exceptional. Don't let them say this. Other people are doing it. Why not join us? We cannot join them because we are different people. And another point here says unforgiveness. Praise the Lord. Amen. Unforgiveness is a bondage. I was in there before, but thank God for the grace of God. You know, because I'm quiet, but I take that quietness to be another thing. I can hold you in mind for years. Amen. When my husband was alive, I can keep malice with him. You know, but God has broken me. God has taken so many things out of my life. So we must forgive. Unforgiveness is like a poison. It's killing you inside. And when you see the person you are holding, you know, holding grudge against, you will not be happy. At times your heart will not skip. Am I correct? So when you are holding somebody down, there's an adage in my place that says, as you are wrestling, you say, I will not leave this person. And the person is down. You, will you stand up? You will not stand up. So all of you will be there. That will not be our portion in Jesus' name. Amen. So we must learn to forgive, no matter what the person has done. No matter, maybe your next sister, you say, she doesn't know what the person has done to me. What has the person done that they have not done to Jesus Christ? You must learn to forgive. Praise the Lord. Like I used to tell my daughter, no matter what he has done, put it up. So he did this last year, last month he did it. I said, put everything aside. Some of us, our hearts are the diary we have. We don't have a school diary, but the heart is there, recording everything. July 2015, he did this. You are recording it. And when the person does it, you say, hey, you have done it. Where is the place for forgiveness? We must learn to forgive one another so that we move ahead. 2 Corinthians 2, 10 to 11. 2 Corinthians 2, 2, 10 to 11. Brother John, that thing is okay. Should we go, man? Praise the Lord. Now, whom you forgive anything, I also forgive. For if I indeed I have forgiven anything, I have forgiven that one for your sakes in the presence of God. The next verse 11. Lest Satan should take advantage of us, for we are not ignorant of his devices. You can see it. We are not ignorant of his devices. You must forgive. When you forgive, it's not for that person, but for Christ's sake. Amen. Amen. And for yourself too, he has hurt me so bad. I cannot forgive. You have a place. How many hearts do you have when you begin to break the little one you have? So you learn to forgive and let go so that you move forward. Christ has forgiven us. If you don't forgive, there is another problem. Then communication gap, we must learn to communicate with one another. Hebrews 13:16. Speak out your mind the way it is. Respect it. Don't dishonor anybody. When you want to make your point known, just speak out. Don't say, okay, they said that we should not argue. You keep quiet. You keep it in your heart. No. Speak out in a polite way, not rudely. Don't insult the person. Let your points be known. This is what I mean. This is how I understand it. And the person brings out his or her own points too. We come together and agree. Don't begin to, you know, I don't want to talk. Let her be on her own and let me be on. You know, we're Christians.
Yeah.
That when we get to heaven, we settle it. Have you heard that speaking before? That's what we say in church. Let her just be on her own and let me be on my own. I'm forgiving her. From my heart, I forgive. Hey, don't deceive yourself. Oh. Don't deceive yourself. Oh. We don't know when the trumpet will sound. You are still breathing. Praise God. The trumpet has not sounded. So please, I'm begging us, no matter what the person has done, learn to forgive. Communicate. Oh, Sister Bookie, you did this to me, and I'm not happy about that. And if she apologizes, okay, even if she doesn't. You know, I've made up my mind. I've said whether the person apologizes or not, I've forgiven. Make up your mind that whether the person says sorry or not, you are forgiving the person. Let go so that you will be free and you'll be happy. Learn to tell the enemy, you cannot steal my job. In this area, I will be joyful. You cannot steal my job. Can somebody say that? You cannot steal my job. You cannot. I will forgive no matter what the person has done. Then unfaithfulness. We need to be faithful. Genesis 39 is talking about the story of Potiphar's wife. How she was luring Joseph to sleep with her. And Joseph took to his heels. He ran, even left his shirt. She lied against him. But one thing Joseph said, oh, I love that statement. How can I do such a wicked thing against my God? So, in the place of unfaithfulness, you must remember God. Are you faithful to God? After he has said that, then the man said, how can I do this against my master? Those of us that are working, are you faithful to your master? Are you faithful to God? As a child of God, you need to be faithful. Even to our children, we need to be faithful. Then financial challenges. We are looking at the points that bring up conflicts. Financial challenges. Money, money, money. The Bible says money is the root, the love of money. It didn't say money. The love of it is the root of all evil. 1 Timothy 6. 1 Timothy 6. The love of money is the root of all evil. 1 Timothy 6, 8. 8 to 10. Quickly. And having food and clothing with this, we shall be content. 9. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare, and into many foolish and harmful lusts, which draw men in destruction and perdition. 10. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, from which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness, and pierced themselves through with sorrows. Amen. The Bible is not saying that it's bad to be rich. No. Because our God is a rich God. He died so that you and I will be rich. So, but the love of it, when we talk about love, there's a difference between love and life. Some people can do anything for money. Anything. Some women can lay their body for money. Some men can do gigolo. Sorry, I don't know what they call it in English. Gigolo. They'll be sleeping with elderly women just so that the woman will be financing them. They can do anything for money. God will have mercy upon us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Those of us here may be better. But back home in Africa where I came from, The meeting, okay, God will deliver us in Jesus' name. Then we should be content. What God has given to us, we should be happy with it. We should be happy with it. Don't begin to eye this person. The car is bigger than my own. I need to get that one. You know that is where it starts from. Little. What this sister book is putting on is so beautiful. I must have it. I must have it by all costs. That is the problem. Some will now go back home and begin to fight their husbands. And we need wisdom. We need wisdom. Finances, money, and we should get to the point where we see that money is not everything in life. Money cannot buy happiness. I was talking with somebody, sorry, just last week. The example that he shared with us last Sunday about the monk church. Fortunately, I was talking with my in-law. He's here in Dallas. And he made up, he said somebody gave, that they brought him $275,000. And he was saying, that God is a child of God. He said he was wondering, what is the money for? Is it to leave his company and join their company? That he did not understand. But later when he got to understand, they wanted him to join them in the church. So when he started telling me that, I said, okay, I remember that story in church. So by the time God, he returned the money. How many of us will return? It's a huge amount, Abby. But he returned it because he has the fear of God. When he got to know their mission, he said no. That he's contented with his $2,500 a week that he's earning. He's okay with it. But for some of us, with that money, no, I will not let go. You will hold on to it. You think you're doing somebody, you're doing yourself. Your spirit already is being caged. But ours will not be caged in Jesus' name. Nothing will steal our salvation. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. No, money is good, but don't love it. It's good, don't love money. Whereby you will give your life for it. Some boys over there, they will sacrifice their mother for money. The money that they cannot use later. They will tell them, don't give the money, your mother the money. So why did you do money ritual? The next one, lack of genuine love. When you don't love genuinely, maybe your love is from the mouth. Maybe the one will say to God, I love you, Jesus, but from the heart, what is happening? Do you love him deep from your heart? Praise the Lord. Colossians 3:19. Are we there? Okay. 3:19, husbands, love your wives and do not be bitter towards them. Love, you know our God is love. Praise the Lord. Our God is love. So you must love. As a child of God, hatred is not in you. That spirit of hatred, kill it every day. Kill it. Amen. So you must love. Praise the Lord. We just have like 3 minutes left. Any question before we close up? Any question? The remaining parts will be taken next week by the grace of God. Any question, contribution? Praise the Lord. None. For God is of love. And anyone that loveth is born of God, and knoweth God. He that loveth not, knoweth no God, for God is love, beloved. Let us love one another, for. Are we there? We are not ready. Praise the Lord. The Corinthians are not ready for us. Praise the Lord. Shall we just pray? Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask, O God Almighty, that you help us, O God, to manage the conflict in our homes. Father, in our places of work, in our lives, every conflict, everything the enemy has brought before us to bring disagreement, Lord, we ask, O God, the grace and wisdom to manage them, give unto us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
And the remaining service we commit into your hands in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. As the choristers come up, help us, O God, to put on our dancing shoes in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Praise the living Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Now he's on our feet. It is time to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The Bible says, let everything that has breath, praise the Lord. If you have breath this morning, sing out to the Lord.
No one like you.
No one.